Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of That Old Ace in the Hole by Annie Proulx, narrated by Tom Stechschulte. This work is copyrighted 2002 by Deadline Limited. This recording is copyrighted 2002 by Recorded Books. The book begins with this proverb: Alle Mullins fangen Wind. And now, That Old Ace in the Hole.
Chapter 1. Global Pork Rind. In late March, Bob Dollar, a young curly-headed man of 25 with the broad face of a cat, pale innocent eyes fringed with sooty lashes, drove east along Texas State Highway 15 in the Panhandle, down from Denver the day before, over the Raton Pass and through the dead volcano country of northeast New Mexico to the Oklahoma Pistol Barrel, then a wrong turn north and wasted hours before he regained the way. It was a roaring spring morning with green in the sky, the air spiced with sand sagebrush and aromatic sumac. NPR faded from the radio in a string of announcements of corporate supporters, replaced by a Christian station that alternated pabulum preaching and punchy music. He switched to shit-kicker airwaves and listened to songs about staying home, going home, being home, and the errors of leaving home. The road ran along a railroad track. He thought the bend of the rails unutterably sad. Those cold and gleaming strips of metal turning away into the distance made him think of the morning he was left on Uncle Tam's doorstep, listening for the inside clatter of coffee pot and cups, although there had been no train nor tracks there. He didn't know how the rails had gotten into his head as symbols of sadness. Gradually, the ancient thrill of moving against the horizon into the great yellow distance heated him. For even fenced and cut with roads, the overwhelming presence of grassland persisted, though nothing of the original prairie remained. It was all flat expanse and wide sky. Two coyotes looking for afterbirths trotted through a pasture to the east, moving through fluid grass, the sun backlighting their fur in such a way that they appeared to have silver linings. Irrigated circles of winter wheat, dotted with stalker calves, grew on land as level as a runway. In other fields, tractors lashed tails of dust. He noticed the habit of slower drivers to pull into the breakdown lane, here called the courtesy lane, and wave them on. Ahead, cities loomed. But as he came close, the skyscrapers, mosques, and spires metamorphosed into grain elevators, water towers, and storage bins. The elevators were the tallest buildings on the plains, symmetrical, their thrusting shapes seeming to entrap kinetic energy. After a while, Bob noticed their vertical rhythm, for they rose up regularly every 5 or 10 miles in trackside towns. Most were concrete cylinders, some brick or tile. But at many sidings, the old wood elevators, peeling and shabby, still stood, some surfaced with asbestos shingles, a few with rusted metal loosened by the wind. Rectilinear streets joined at 90-degree angles. Every town had a motto: the town where no one wears a frown, the richest land and the finest people, 10,000 friendly people and one or two old grumps. He passed the Car View Drive-In, a midtown plywood Jesus, dead cows by the side of the road, legs stiff as 2x4s, waiting for the renderer's truck. There were nodding pump jacks and pivot irrigation rigs, one still decked out in Christmas lights. To the left and right, condensation tanks and complex assemblies of pipes and gauges. Though such was the size of the landscape and their random placement, that they seemed metal trinkets strewn by a vast and careless hand. Orange and yellow signs marked the existence of underground pipelines, for beneath the fields and pastures lay an invisible world of pipes, cables, boreholes, pumps, and extraction devices, forming with the surface fences and roads a monstrous three-dimensional grid. This grid extended into the sky through contrails and invisible satellite transmissions. At the edge of fields, he noticed brightly painted V8 diesel engines, most converted to natural gas, pumping up water from the Ogallala aquifer below. And he passed scores of anonymous, low-gray buildings with enormous fans at their ends, set back from the road and surrounded by chain-link fence. From the air, these guarded hog farms resembled strange grand pianos with 6 or 10 white keys, the trapezoid shape of the body, the effluent lagoon in the rear. Still, all of these machines and wire and metal buildings seemed ephemeral. He knew he was on prairie, what had once been part of the enormous North American grassland extending from Canada to Mexico, showing its thousand faces to successions of travelers who described it in contradictory ways. Under gritty spring wind, the grass blew sidewise, figured with bluets and anemones, pussytoes and Johnny jump-ups, alive with birds and antelope. In midsummer, away from the overgrazed trail margins, they traveled through groin-high grass rolling in waves. Those on the trail in late summer saw dry, useless desert studded with horse-crippling cactus. Few, except working cowboys, ventured onto the plains in winter when stinging northers swept snow across it. Where once the howling of wolves was heard, now sounded the howl of tires. Bob Dollar had no idea he was driving into a region of immeasurable natural complexity that some believed abused beyond saving. He saw only what others had seen, the bigness, pump jacks, nodding pterodactyl heads, road alligators cast off from the big semi-tires. Every few miles, a red-tailed hawk marked its hunting boundary. The edges of the road were misty with purple-flowered wild mustard whose rank scent embittered the air. He said to the rearview mirror, "Some flat-ass place." Though it seemed he wasn't so much in a place as confronting the raw material of human use. A white van turned out of a side road in front of him, and he narrowed his eyes. He knew white vans were favored by the criminally insane and escaped convicts, that the bad drivers of the world gravitated to them. The van sped away, exceeding the speed limit, and faded out of sight. There appeared, far ahead, on the other side of the road, a wobbling black dot that resolved into a bicyclist. A trick of the heated air magnified the bicycle, which appeared 30 feet high and shivered as though constructed of aspic. He passed another hawk on a telephone pole. The great prairie dog cities of the short grass plains, which once covered hundreds of square miles, were gone. But some old-fashioned red-tails continued to hunt as their ancestors, in flat-shouldered soar, turning methodically in the air above the prairie, yellow eyes watching for the shiver of grass. Many more had taken up modern ways and sat atop convenient poles and posts, waiting for vehicles to clip rabbits and prairie dogs. They retrieved the carrion with the insolent matter-of-factness of a housewife carelessly slinging a package of chops into her shopping cart. Such a hawk, a bit of fur stuck to the side of its beak, watched the bicyclist pumping along west. As the machine moved slowly through the focus of those amber eyes, the bird lost interest. The bicycle had no future in the hawk world. More rewarding were trucks on the paved highways, grills spattered with blood, weaving pickups that aimed for jacks and snakes as though directed by the superior will on a telephone pole. The bicyclist, reduced to human size, and Bob Dollar, in his sedan, drew abreast. The bicyclist saw a red-flushed face. Bob had a glimpse of a stringy leg and a gold chain. Then the bicycle descended a dip in the road. Alone on the highway again, Bob squinted at a wadded quilt of cloud crawling over the sky. There unrolled beside the Saturn the level land, every inch put to use for crops, oil, gas, cattle, service towns. The ranches were set far back from the main road, and now and then he passed an abandoned house, weather-burned, surrounded by broken cottonwoods. In the fallen windmills and collapsed outbuildings, he saw the country's fractured past scattered about like the pencils on the desk of a draftsman who has gone to lunch. The ancestors of the place hovered over the bits and pieces of their finished lives. He didn't notice the prairie dog that raced out of the roadside weeds into his path, and the tires bumped slightly as he hit it. A female red tail lifted into the air. It was the break she had been waiting for. Bob Dollar was a stranger in the double panhandle country north of the Canadian River. He had held two jobs in the 5 years since he had graduated from Horace Greeley Junior University, a hybrid institution housed in a cinder block building at the edge of an onion field off Interstate 70, east of Denver. He'd expected enlightenment at Horace Greeley.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.